I think that was kind of one of the tough decisions I've made, right? Because I mean, I'm going to work for Google and Amazon for 30 years, 40 years till I retire, or do I want to do something even bigger?
I'm here with Eric Wei, CEO and founder of Timelyhero. Eric, how are you doing today?
Yeah, I'm super busy. I'm preparing for the press release tomorrow, but I'm basically doing good. How are you doing?
That's great. Press release tomorrow.
Yeah.
It's exciting.
It is.
Nice. And so, yeah, I was wondering if maybe if you could give us a little bit of your background and maybe some of your work history, and then we'll go into what led to Timelyhero.
Sure, of course. So I'm originally born and raised in Taiwan, kind of finished my graduate school in Taiwan. So I was major in e-commerce and supply chain management. And during that time, my case study was Amazon.com. So this is one of the reasons why I came to Japan and straight work for Amazon at a time when they were just a venture, right, back then. And so I ended up working 10 years for Amazon, and after that, kind of working 3 years at the Google Place across APAC. Then sort of like jump into the sexy of the startup industry and straight launching Didi and as well as FoodPanda in Japan. So then right now, like, is the time to kind of found my own company. So I'm at my 3 years of my current companies. And so this is who I am right now.
Nice, super exciting. And so you mentioned, let's start at the beginning.
Right.
And we'll work our way
sure.
No, that's perfect. And so what I wanted to ask was about Amazon. Mm-hmm. And so you came to Japan. Why Japan, I guess, actually is the first question.
Yeah, that's a good question. So Japan is always one of my dream places to work for. And I was growing up by like animation and comics and I love a lot. And I really hope that one day I can just follow in the animations without, you know, checking the subtitles. And so that's one reason why I kind of want me to choose Japan. And another reason, sort of like at the time, I only have one company I want to work for, which is Amazon. They only have one office in Asia, which is in Tokyo.
Wow, I had no idea. What really, like a real venture at that point, like you mentioned.
It is this, right? Nice. So, as a foreigner, so I would come here without an offer, right? So I came here with 3 months of sightseeing, you know, it's kind of tourist visa, right? And so that's why I get it, right? So I only have 90 days. I need to get a deal done. If not, I'm going home, right? Go big or go home. It's kind of my set. And so I can apply for Amazon. Luckily, after 3 weeks, I got an offer. Then, you know, starting my career in Japan.
Wow, that's amazing. It's like that's like literally everyone's dream. I feel like they come to Japan and like you found a job within those 3 months. That's amazing. And so you mentioned that you wanted to be able to watch anime with no subtitles. I'm still not there myself. I'm trying to get there. And for you, did you learn Japanese before moving here, or was it something that after you started working for Amazon you worked on?
Yeah, no. When I was in university, right, and so I would kind of took some Japanese as my, you know, some lessons over there and get some credits, right, and that was kind of the starting of my kind of journey of learning Japanese as to get started. So yeah, no, I came here with a little bit tiny Japanese with me.
Wow, that's amazing. And so, and to help you get that job at Amazon, do you think your background in like in your degree in e-commerce? Like, was that like what kind of clinched it, or like how did you make that happen in those 90 days?
Yeah, definitely. So that was an interesting story, right? So when I applied for them, I got interviews, and well, I was speaking nearly zero Japanese, right? And so I remember like when I stayed in the meeting rooms, and I would just bring my laptop and open it up, and I would actually doing the presentation of the things I know about the supply chain management and Amazon's, and I told the interviewer said about. This is my understanding. This is why I thought like the company would face this kind of challenges. This is what I'm going to do on that one. And this is what I'm capable of doing, right? So I remember like this is just the first few interviews where I do it in Japan. It's pretty much a kind of sort of like a co-sharing session type of things with interviewers. So it's quite unusual. But
wow, that's so cool. I'm so you worked for Amazon for 10 years. I'm sure you saw a lot of change in that time. I mean, it's grown, like the last 10 years of Amazon is insane to recap even in the States, right? And so, I wonder if you could maybe give us some of the insight. And you worked in Japan, but then you also worked a little bit in China as well. And so maybe we could talk a little bit about that difference between maybe Japan Amazon and China Amazon and those changes that you saw over that period.
Right. Cool. Yeah. So I think that was the 2 years after joining Amazon Japan, and wow, that was time. And well, people are talking about Beijing Olympic, and another of that is that we're about to acquire a company in China. So we actually done an MAA there and acquired a local company, gojoyo.com. Then, so we kind of started to pick up some of the people from each of the locale, right? And to go to China to form up a venture team and to kind of help set up the company. Then at the time in Japan, I'm probably the first one and the only one speak Mandarin. And so no doubt, I'm just 3 years in the company and I'm good enough to do that. But I know, you want me to go, I just go, right? And so with that mindset, and I was just really okay to Amazon China for 2 years and living in Beijing. And basically, the culture is so different, right? So over there, and I still remember like first day when I got in office, right? And so, well, the fax machine was nonstop printing things. I said, oh, what is going on? And, you know, is this Amazon or, you know, because I think at the time, Amazon China still used the fax machine to print the purchase orders to the vendors. And it was kind of 24 hours and nonstop, right? So that's the first experience when I first day step into the office. Yeah,
that's amazing. Yeah, that's surreal. And so how long were you in China? You said 2 years,
yeah,
or 3 years to set up that
such
office. Wow, yeah. That's intense. That's cool. And so then after that, you came back to Japan, right. Stayed with Amazon for a little bit beyond that, another 4 years,
right?
And then decided to move to Google. And right. At Google, you were head of APAC. For Google Play, for the
right.
Play Store, right?
Correct.
And so maybe if you could talk a little bit about what that transition was like and maybe the highest points or the lowest points of maybe working for Amazon and then working for Google.
Right. So, you know, so I was working on the secret ninja project was called Kindle, right? So like we were hiding in the very like a secret rooms and only like the CEO of the company have the access to that rooms. And we cannot tell anyone else what we're doing in Amazon Japan. And, you know, so then we kind of prepared for the Kindle project and we launched that and we kind of hit the market pretty well, right? So the market reactions and the business growth, it was quite well and was leading out the Kindle contents operation team that time. And it's all good, but there's nothing bad about Amazon. I still love that. And so even still today, I'm still a heavy user of Amazon using that almost every week and it's kind of deliver, knock my door every day, right? So. So the reason why, I think this is one day Google reached out to me via LinkedIn and directly is from HR of Google and checking about like, you know, we are going to find a lead and to be able to do a match at APAC for Google Play that will include the business like digital books that you were doing in Kindle. On top of that, there will be something else like entertainment, including the movies and TV contents, which I didn't have experience. I was like, wait a moment. I said, I didn't have experience about APAC at the time, right? So yeah, I do have the experience in Japan, China, but you're talking about India, Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, Hong Kong, Taiwan, Korea, right? There's so many countries you can name it right in Asia. I say, and on top of that, I'm totally like zero experience in the movies and TV industries. And I asked the recruiter again, say, I really sure I'm the one, you know, you want to hire because like, you know, vertically, horizontally, like, you know, I just didn't have that experience. And I think a very interesting response from Google at the time is say, we want to see about your approach, right? So I know like you don't have experience doing that and we can see that from your background, right? So like, if you are the head of APAC, how are you going to address the challenges, right? And how are you going to hit the movie and TV business, right? And so tell me about your approach. Right, and so this is how I get started. And I kind of said about out of nowhere, said about, oh yeah, okay, assuming if I'm the head of the APAC, and this is how we're gonna drive the business. And well, luckily, it seems like apparently like the leadership team there like the answer I have, right? So that's why I kind of jump into the world of Google.
That's awesome. And so you spent 3 years at Google developing that business across APAC. What were some of maybe those challenges that you did end up facing across like the markets that you mentioned throughout Asia? And how did they compare to Japan? I know every market's different, but maybe how do they compare to Japan?
Right. So that's quite a challenge, right? Because you were talking about the movie contents, like each country have their different popular movie genre, right? And so from the studio perspective, you want to make one movies and you want to have the super hit in every single countries, which most of the case doesn't happen, right? So so that's why we're kind of looking to the user insight and market insight about what kind of movie content or TV content does this country's user love. And we're also looking to the, about the, well, the supply and demand, right? Whether we have a lot of enough contents so we don't need to build that again, or do is it lacking a certain area we want to build? So yeah, each country was kind of different. Like for example, the country of the developing countries like India and Indonesia at the time, right? And back then they were very interested about the self-help and this kind of learning. How can I get so better? How can I earn more money? Right, and this kind of contents is not going to sell in Japan, right? So it's got a little bit difference. And well, what I noticed about this old country differences, and what we want to do is what we want to personalize is the contents, you know, per users. And so that's what I learned a lot from there from that.
That's super interesting. Yeah, I think it's funny because you're right. Every studio definitely want even products, right? Like PNG, they want to develop a product that'll sell in each market, and it's just not usually the case for like 90% right. of products. Yeah, that's awesome. Okay, cool. And so from there, from Google, you ended up joining Didi. And so what made it the right time to maybe move from big tech to something a little bit smaller, a little bit, like, well, it's interesting because, well, I'll let you say it actually, yeah.
Yeah, so that's a good question, right? So I think that was kind of one of the tough decisions I have made, right? Because joined from a company, Google at the time was the number one company people want to work for, right? So, and with the very generous salary package, right? You could ask for more, right? So then on top of that, there's perks in the office, right? Everything's free. They get a swag every day. You get unlimited candy and cookie and chocolates here and there, right? And three meals a day all free. You get free massage points, the thing. It's really, really hard to get out from that comfort zone. But I think it's more about for the personal, like career path building type of things. I really think about, yeah, I know how to grow companies and, you know, build from 100 to 1,000, right? So, but that would be so interesting about learn how to do the 0 to 1, 1 to 100. So that was like, I kind of look around in Google, that's really no space because we're talking about a billion active users business we already hold handling, right? So then, one at a time, I will also build a lot of like market analysis. I helped APAC to grow, and especially for a company to grow from one company, one country to another countries, right? So do the country expansion, and also analysis about what kind of things gonna go big in the next few years. I remember at that time we even built some analysis to 2050 while we were in 2020. So we're building 30-year strategies, and like last, I know about which country gonna be doing what, you know, for that years, right? And from that, we actually see that out of VR, AR, blockchains, fintech, a lot of things. There's one thing that catch my attention, which is share economy, and so that's what I do. I do think about like for the area of the Japan. I think there's a room to get better, right, in terms of the share economies, and so. And also always as Google, I always provide a lot of very extended, very long document about the analysis and market insight, how to do it, right? So it's more on like planning side of the business. I would think about like, it would be very interesting if I get into the other side, right? If I can get into the execution side of the business and be knowing about how developers were thinking about building the countries and on the business of their own, right? So that would be so interesting. And so that's why, like, you know, I got a call and about these opportunities, and while Didi and SoftBank is about to join the build a joint ventures in Japan, right? And so you'll be at very super early stages while the product is not built yet, right? And the people is still on the way to hire the whole entire organizations. And so I feel about, well, there's not no better than opportunity than that, you know. So that's one reason I joined Didi and for that.
That's awesome. That's great. I actually have two follow-up questions there.
Yep.
The first one is, you worked with Wahl+Case for that opportunity, right? And so yep. How did Wahl+Case help maybe there? Or when you spoke with, were you working with Brian?
Yep.
When you spoke with Brian Chang, I'm going to talk to the camera actually for a second. Brian Chang, our managing director, in case you're not aware. So you worked with Brian for that. And what, maybe what was some of the perspectives that he talked to you about, or what made that relationship work?
Right. Brian and me are friends before work, right? So we know each other for decades, right? So basically, we were talking about am I going to work for Google and Amazon for 30 years, 40 years till I retire? Or do I want to do something even bigger? And do I want to try something grounded up and trying to get this kind of a 0 to 100 experience? And so that's where we kind of have some discussion over there. And Brian was super helpful in terms of talking about, oh yeah, these are the pros and these are the cons, right? So we're talking about the benefit perks, right? So that's something you wouldn't expect from a startup company would provide, right? So that was sort of like, yeah, that's something if you choose, you would lose those kind of perks. But on the flip side is you basically even get less perks, you get less of the salary package, but this is what we will earn, right? So the experience is really, you're gonna help grow up a company from zero. And this kind of 0 to 1 experience is pretty priceless. And so that's what I kind of hear about that. And also combined with my knowledge of when I learned from Google about, well, sharing comment is on the grow, right? And so that's why I said about, okay, why not? We give it a try. And so to see about who were the people we're gonna work with and what will be the budget look like and what will be the company's plan look like. And so that's kind of how we got started. So we actually didn't, Brian was super helpful to help me to bring this kind of information as well. So, okay, this will be like the budget or company plan. So this will be like, it's kind of be, you've seen about 1 year, 2 years from now, this is what they want trying to invest in this country. So I think that's important for me because it's like I'm not gonna join after 3 months like we kind of went bankrupt, right? So then that wouldn't be a good move, right? So I got this kind of information overall. Like, I kind of did interviews and luckily I kind of passed all those interviews and I kind of got into the roles as its chief of product officers for the company. And again, I think that's another reason why I choose this because in my past career, I've never been a CPO before, right? So I didn't even have a chance to or experience to manage a product team, right? And so, and this is something like to me personally, it is something I really love a lot because every move to the next job, I always want to make sure like there are more than 80% of things I can learn. Maybe I will use 20% of things I already know how to do it, right? So. And so we're gonna make sure, okay, and this 80% definitely is up there, right? 0 to 1 experiences. I've never done the product lead before, right? And so, and I never always work for an American company. I never worked for a Japanese and the Chinese companies before, right? So at the time, for me, it's a very interesting mindset about, I want to work for the top 3 or 4 GDP countries in the world. That's the kind of personal goal of myself. And I work for America, right? It's literally the number one, right? So, and number two and number three, I say, oh, okay, that's China and Japan, right? And a building joint venture, I can click 2 cars once, right? just one move. And so I said, oh, I'll do it, right? So I click the top 3 then back then. So yeah, that was a good experience working with Wahl+Case that time.
It's amazing. Yeah, I love, so there's a couple of things there I think that are really great. I love that concept that you just outlined, and it's not something I've ever heard before, but I think it's really valuable actually of shooting for somewhere where you don't know like 80% of what you're going to be doing, like 80% learnings. Like I think that's like the real way to make progress. Like, because if you only go with what you know or what you have experience in, it's very incremental, right? You get like a little bit better every time. But if you go for like that 80% increase, it's like huge. And you have so much more experience when you're leaving that and you can apply it to so many more things. That's beautiful. Yeah, I've never heard that outline. I think that's really awesome. And the other thing that stood out to me was, going back a little bit, was that you mentioned the gig economy specifically, or not gig economy, shared economy specifically. Mm-hmm. And with both Didi and then FoodPanda and now Timelyhero,
right.
This is like kind of one of those cornerstones that you've sort of really connected with, you personally. And so what I wanted to ask you was, from Didi and FoodPanda and now Timelyhero, how has the adoption of that shared economy happened in Japan? And then what are maybe some of those challenges that have been presented before you around that shared economy?
Right. And so so first we started from the ride sharing business, right? And so you know, like that was Uber, right? There's Lyft, right? In the US, kind of very popular at the time. But like, was in Japan, they were still not the things, right? When we launched Didi. And by the challenge there, what we can see about in Japan market is, well, I think about Japan itself is they like it's sort of like a little bit hybrid of the innovation and sort of social security or sort of like the kind of things that combine together from the government perspective, right? So they love innovation, but they don't want the innovation built on top of sacrificing certain peoples, right? And so from their perspective, it's like, you know, if we bring that to Japan, we can allow, kind of deregulate that part. Then in Japan, we have more than 100,000 of the professional drivers, taxi drivers, will lose their job. And their average age is 59 years old. And they will not be able to help them to arrange for the next career path. So that's a tough challenge. I cannot speak on behalf of government, but I can understand why they come up with this regulation is they need to protect the taxi industries. They cannot afford to have those kind of people losing job and, you know, staying at home, right? So that's why the government sort of can jump in into the angle is about, is that actually you don't need to destruct the things totally before you can build the new things, right? So sort of kind of we come up with approach about we work with the taxi industry. We always organization said about, okay, we're going to be a SaaS company in a sense, you know, we build the best products to help to dispatch your taxis, help you to catch the demands, you know, real time, and which is you don't need to have your taxi just driving empties, you know, around the streets, you know, wasting for gasoline, wasting for your time, right? So again, and I think sort of like with sharing economy, one thing is how can we utilize this, you know, the best of the time? How can you kind of help the environment? How can you help not to create any traffic, you know, for empty cars? And so that's kind of sort of like what I kind of basically, when I trying to get into the restaurant business, how we're going to challenge the first challenge kind of mass in Japan and how we handle that.
That's awesome. Yeah, I think that's a great perspective, especially around, yeah, I think disruption gets kind of thrown around as this term to mean, or it can almost be synonymous with like, with big improvements.
Right.
And I don't know if it's like so appropriate, but I do think that idea of the shared economy kind of plugging in and sort of opening up those valves that are maybe, or those bottlenecks that have been happening throughout other industries is a great way to look at it. And so that's with Didi specifically. And then when you moved to FoodPanda, was it those same sort of challenges that you were facing with trying to integrate that into the system that's already in place?
Right. I think the thing you mentioned about Didi is excessive rise. And sort of like, what we look into this areas when we work with the companies, the leadership team is also, yeah, so if we allow the individual drivers to replace the professional taxi drivers, it may be like, well, people will spend a lower price and will be able to help, you know, to the adoption of the new technologies. But we actually look in something even far, right? So at the time, we're thinking about autonomous car, right? So instead of switching from professional driver, individual drivers, then we want to think about how can we jump directly from professional taxi driver to one day to have the autonomous car to assist a human being, right? So in the future, we'd see like, you know, maybe 10 years, 20 years from now, you would see a lot of taxi on the street without drivers, right? And so that's something is really, I think, including Didi, a lot of companies are going to look in this area. How can we make it happen, right? So one thing without mindset is do not struggle about with the regulation. How can you really define a new area where you can bring your innovative things in there and really create for the future, right? And so that's something we're going to talk about with Didi. And also, I think I've sort of connect to the FoodPanda as well, right? So, well, so FoodPanda right now, when I launched the business, right, I was the first one to join the companies. But again, I was always have my 80-20 rules and still apply to myself, right? Mm. And that's sort of like, that's the country CEO role, right? So, wait a minute, I've never become the CEO of any companies before, right? So, and how to manage the sales, marketing, P&L, balance sheet, you know, economics, legal, government relationship, customer service, everything's over there, right? So I said, I'm not sure, but I've never done that before, but whether I would do it or not, right? But But I didn't always have the belief in, you know, if I can keep 20%, I already know I should be good, right? And so that's one of the things sort of when I move into the FoodPanda, right? So as the first one to join, and I would do everything ground up myself. And I was kind of launching that thing during the COVID, which is there's no international team can visit Japan for a few months. So I was the only one, and it's pretty much open up the bank accounts, you know, and can open up offices. And we kind of, we launched 10 offices over Japan, like Tokyo, Sapporo, Kobe, Fukuoka, those kind of city offices. And when we have 10 offices, well, we only have like 7 full-time employees at the time. So we have more office than employee that we have that time. Right, and so that's why it's sort of like we work with Wahl+Case and, you know, times to kind of help. I think one of the challenges we see in the startup industry, you know, is because like the company just grow the awareness from zero, right? Where nobody heard about you, don't know about your the services. And on top of that, when we do FoodPanda at the time, they're already Uber Eats, they're already Demigon in market for more than 5 years, right? So we're there, we have to explain about why we're different. Right. And so while we don't even have the app launches, right. And so that's extremely hard situation to hire the talents in the track then to join a company. And so I remember like we kind of sit down with Wahl+Case and also the recruiters a couple of times. How can we really hire a team fast enough? Say like, hey, we do have budget. We have the plain budget and we do want to expand at this speed. Right, and so in the startup, we're always talking about 100-day plan, right? So how can we hit 100 days, right? So that's why I remember like just they're kind of revving up and a thing, and sort of meantime, I spent more than half of my time kind of recruiting up the teams and to kick up the start for the FoodPanda.
That's super interesting. Yeah, I love that. I love that perspective. And I, again, like having that 80% increase in kind of in experience and intelligence or in knowledge is awesome. Like I think having that. And which leads me to my next question really is throughout your career, you've kind of been building towards being the zero employee, right? The founder, the right. CEO founder. And so now with Timelyhero, what lessons have you sort of taken from maybe each stage of your career that have let you launch this business?
Right. So that's a good question, right? So so I think it's all connected, right? So this is none of the past career was kind of wasting my time, right? So because as a, you know, if you connect these four opportunities, I'm all doing B2C, right? And doing about the global products, right? That we expand to multiple countries, right? And that have this kind of similarity that connect to why I'm getting to building the B2C platform business and aiming for global. Right, so I've set up the target of things which I'm very comfortable in. Also, I know how that works, you know, from 0 to 1, 1 to 100 to 100 to 100,000, right? So that's the first thing, kind of pick up the kind of angle or industries that when I'm doing that. So that will kind of connect it. And also, I think one thing I really learned a lot is sort of like, I've been doing the like project management, I'm doing about the operation manager, I'm doing about the sales and also the marketing. As well, so I kind of know about whole entire areas. Also, with the experience of FoodPanda, who is kind of in charge of whole entire P&L, right, of the companies, and how to set up strategies, you know, for next year, for next 3 years, and you know how to come up with budgeting plans, and how to set up a recruiting team, how to define for how many headcount per each of the team size, right? How can you build all charts? And so each of the stage of a career actually helped me to have enough knowledge that I don't need to Google it.
Yeah.
I don't need to Google it to know about how to fund out my company, right? Because I have the experience myself right now. Set up it's also my first time founding a company, right? But you know, at least you know, I'm not going to be afraid because I 80-20% rule apply to myself, right? And so at the time, sort of like yeah, so I would just go ahead and fundraising a new thing for me, right? So that's the first time I have to build a product that's not coming from my idea, right? So this is the first time I have to build an approach from the ideation to the product building and to test the market and try the programmatic fee, all those kind of things. But I think that's sort of all connected to the each of the career I've been building to the company what I'm building.
That's awesome. Do you want to give a little bit of an introduction as to what Timelyhero does and what that idea was that you built the company around?
Sure. So Timelyhero is a platform to allow people to sell their skill and time, right? And to connect to the one that need your skills and, you know, in the world, right? So I think where it's coming from is because we know today's world that most of people actually, when you work for full time somewhere, or even you're working as freelancers, you're not applying for your best skill at your current job, right? And so right now, like people were recently in this 1-2 year, people were starting to talk about, you know, side projects, especially in Japan, right? So in the past, it's highly regulated, right? So a lot of companies doesn't allow their employee to do side project because you're not loyal to your company, right? And you should work as long as possible for your company, right? So, and which I think that's not the right thing, right? So sort of how can we embrace the people, be able to kind of release the best skills, right? And you market yourself, right? You put a price, you know, what is it per hour, per 30 minutes, and what you're going to do? Are you going to be mentoring or instructing or kind of teaching, consulting, right? Of things, you can be a musician, you can be a chef, you can be, you know, it can be a retired athlete, right? And you're pretty sure you're very good at one thing, right? And so that's something we feel about that. So the idea coming from when I was the CEO of the FoodPanda, right? And we hired more than like 10,000 delivery boys over Japan, right? And we look into who they are, right? So well, some of them were kind of Tokyo University, Kyoto University students, and it could be a comedian. Some of them are musicians, some of them are retired athletes, and some of them are chef, right? Even chef themselves, they're doing food delivery, right? So, you know, for others, right? And so what I think they have something in common is they have the skill within their brand, with the speaking, with their drawing, with their hands, right? With their hearts, right? So with the knowing about their knowledge and things, but they're using their leg at work, right? And they're riding on the bicycle and to pick up the food and drop the food. It doesn't mean like it's not the right, you know, it's not a decent job to do, but it's sort of about if they have the choice, right? And they could have choose something that can apply their basket on, which we will end up earning more and also giving more to the society on the best assets, right? And so this is where I come out, in Japan, there's really not a platform that's, you know, kind of provide this kind of infrastructure for people here, right? And so that's why why I'm kind of setting up the Timelyhero to make it possible. And so to achieve sort of, the vision is like to encourage people to grow their skill, right? And when you have a skill, you are comfortable to work from anywhere, anytime, you know, and sort of like once you have build your own brand, and you should become comfortable, you know, not relying too much on the just company you're applying for. And so that's something that sort of like interests me a lot. And it's, I want to contribute it in this kind of, you know, get economy from that angle.
That's amazing. I love that. Yeah, I think, it's nice to see. I think a part of what you said is kind of like people are multifaceted. Like, as you mentioned, like doing food delivery isn't a bad job, but then they're like, you mentioned, they also maybe had other skills that they wanted to express, and giving them that platform to be able to express them, I think is really beautiful and really awesome. And so my next question is, so you had the idea and you kind of saw that maybe there was this market gap. What made you feel like this is the time to start Timelyhero? Like, was it the idea that came first, or did you kind of decide like, I want to start my own company first and then found the idea?
Yeah, sort of. I always have the plan to launch my own companies when I was a kid. And so I was growing in the family while my father is a founder himself as well. Like he's a dropout, not from college, but from junior high school.
Wow.
So he didn't like to study, and he always pretend like he's a sick and not going to school, and I get fired, right? Sort of like, it's kind of drop out from that first year of the junior high school. Then he started doing some part-time jobs and kind of learning, you know, kind of learning about skill and from the masters. But he started up to his company when he was like 16 years old, right? And so that was sort of like something, a mindset that, you know, was built when I was kids, is like, if we have a capability, if we have the skill, then we should think about, not think about how much we earn as a salary, it's more think about how can we help to help more people, have more family to another life, right? If we can have the capability to do that and kind of fund up the company and do something was not, there's no one's doing, that can create a strong social impact. So that's sort of like from the education what I have from my dad. And so, and I was kid that with me. And so it's when is the timing to set it up. So I got a pressure from my dad every year asking about when are you going to start your company? When are you going to start your company? I got a pressure from my dad and my manager. But it's sort of like, you know, I still have a lot of things to learn. I'm doing well. I'm already working in Google. What do you ask for, right? So yeah, so I just remember like the first thing when I came to Japan, I worked for Amazon, right? Well, Amazon was kind of just the adventures after the last around 100 people in the companies. And the majority is selling books, right? So I heard from my dad about I'm working for Amazon. I say, why are you moving yourself to Japan, doing a part-time job for a bookstore? And I say, oh wow, like you actually are not saying anything wrong, but like you know, this is something you're looking. Is a first is an online store, but you were selling books and well, but you know, so yeah, I'm actually working for a bookstore. Yeah, that's right, online bookstore. But like, you know, so sort of is those kind of funny stories. I always hear from my dad, I get challenged by my dad about like, you know, do something more and, you know, don't get into a comfort zone. So like, I get a lot of reminder from that. And so, yeah, so I'm not going to do any part-time job for anyone else, right? So that's the time I feel about like setting my goal around 40, is about a time to kind of start a company which have the good, like extensive, like almost 20 years of working experiences, you know, to help me to build a company that I can be fully responsible, right? And for the people I'm hiring, or for the business I'm building, for the business partner I'm working with, and for, you know, so those kind of things will kind of help me also to connect to how can I work with government, how can we expand the business globally, right? And so that's what I feel about like comfortable to kind of launch these companies when I feel like, oh, I'm ready to do.
That's awesome. Really inspiring. And so my next question is about startup culture in Japan. And so you've been in this market for a long time. You've mentioned almost 20 years. Have you seen the startup culture kind of change? Did you feel like that contributed to your decision to launch this business now? What are maybe some of those changes you've seen?
Right. So so in Japan, they actually call it startup gannen, right, in the year of 2022. Actually, I founded my company in 2021, so even 1 year before the gannen, right? So that's sort of like I would be able to at the place to talk about like prior government announced they're gonna support in startup industries versus now they started to support, right? So it just in these 2-3 years things changed a lot, right? So in the past, sort of a few years ago, well government didn't. You know, really, they of course they support a lot of like big companies, small and medium companies go to grow, and how can they survive in the tough moment of COVID, right? So while they didn't have much of budget or time to be able to really, really focus on a startup, right? While at the time they kind of look into, okay, Japan versus Singapore versus, you know, US, right? GDP wise, Japan is higher than Singapore. Well, if you look into the startup industry and also the unicorn that journey from the country, right? And you can note about the money we're putting into from the venture capital into the startups. Japan is so behind, right? And in that sense. And so a few years ago, and well, the industry and the government started to pay attention to that. And so then we're starting to, so I see about the change of that is right now, government starting to put the KPI for themselves, right? They want 10x the number of the startup companies. They want 10x of unicorn that journey from Japan, right? Which is not an easy thing because we are talking about like just a single digit of unicorn in Japan that journey in the past few years, literally, right? And you want to make it to, you know, 50, 100, right? Unicorn companies, it's not easy. But it's good, like when government saying that, literally mean it, right? That means that they will secure some of the budgets, right? And starting to support the industry by providing some of the, almost free, like it's kind of job fairs and to allow startups to hire people easily. start to let people know about working at a startup is a cool thing, right? It's not a minor, right? So you have choices, and a startup could be one of them, right? So all kind of events or this kind of societies, and also they also even create some of the offices in Tokyo, a couple of places, you can use that for free for a year or a year and a half, right? And so they also assist you in terms of opening up for bank accounts, you know, how can I set up all basic things? So just waiting for the ideas comes up, right? And so that's what I feel like in the, we're talking about the year when I started companies, there's very minimum of supports versus now. Well, you definitely have to way more supports and from the government and from the venture capitals and trying to help it grow.
Nice. Yeah. Yeah. It's interesting that you mentioned some of those programs. I remember at the event attending that you invited us to, actually was the Startup Island Taiwan. Yep. Yeah. Event in Tokyo. And one of the presenters was from JETRO, which I think is like the government's yep. like focus on startups and like trying to help them.
Right.
Like you mentioned the offices and stuff. It's amazing to see how much it really has changed even in the 2 to 3 years, like you mentioned. It's surreal. Yeah. And that perception of like startups, like you said, before it was kind of seen as like a minor, like, oh, little bit scary, too high risk. But that perception has sort of started to change thanks to the government as well. And so I can see how you would feel like this was maybe the best time to do that. And then for you also, as a foreigner in Japan, have there been any particular challenges to starting a company here, or what has been your experience?
Right. So that's the, I think as a foreign founders in Japan is quite rare. Right, so if you're talking about foreigners in Japan, overall it's just 2% of the population. But if you look into the startup industry, that's even smaller than that, right? And so of course we get a ton of challenges about, like, because they are quite a lot of paperwork, right? And so that's all written in Japan, is in the long articles and things. I would kind of think about, oh, whether I should allocate more time on building the beautiful documents or, you know, make it perfect, or should I build a business, right? So as a foreigner, I feel about like that's really, really one of the challenges about, like, you know, I don't want to fill a lot of paperwork, and I want to really focus on building the products. I really want to deliver the products. I want to see the user reactions. I want to see where the market fit is there, right? So that's something that you have some build things in parallel as well. I think about as a foreigner, unless you're super, super, super fluent in Japanese, even I live here for more than, you know, 17 years, but still, like, sometimes I feel like it's not easy to fill all the kind of document apps. And so that's one thing. And also, another thing, sort of like the market perspective, how do they look at you, right? So, well, some of the companies or partner or like venture capitals, when I look at you, they will ask you, why are you setting up your business in Japan, right? Why not in Taiwan? Why not in US, right? So then, from the foreigners here, like, we have seen about, like, we actually bring a very good fresh eyes into the markets because we see the gap, right? And so I think that's sort of the, forget about those kind of negative things that we're doing, because we chose about the startup roles and we are preparing for that, right? So for those kind of challenging things. But I think about we should really leverage the strengths of what we have, right? We bring the fresh eye in the markets. We know this place or this part of things kind of more dynamic, right? So that we can have done it better with this approach, right? And when we're talking about the fax machine story, right? So we're using fax machine to print the purchase order. We're not going to buy a new fashion of fax machine to print it faster. Right, we should really think about what our strengths are and apply the best on that one. Okay, let's do EDI. Let's do the new electronic way to do this kind of business. That's why sort of like how I'm thinking about. Yeah, so there's so many good contents in Japan, right? The services. We think about the shokunin culture, right? The Japan's food, right? I never heard anyone complain about getting food in Japan, right? In the past 20 years, and they all always said about that's the best. And you have the most Michelin restaurants in Japan, in Tokyo, even rather than Paris, right? And that's the kind of facts, right? And so there's a lot of good food. And right now, like, you know, how can we kind of spread out the culture as a global, right? So that's still been a very good question, because there's a language barrier, right? And while the more sort of smart and people like what I know in Japan, they are actually quite humble. I said about in a good word, humble, right? They don't really say when they can do something, they're trying to apply certain percentage. Say like, if they can do 100, they will say about maybe I can do 60 or maximum I can try 670. But actually, you're at 100, right? So that's why it kind of set up my perspective of the Japan. But when you get into that, when you know him good enough, you feel that, oh, this is really a master. Well, the way he do is really, really, really impressive, right? And so that's something like sort of like we're going to talk about like as a foreigners, and I can see the difference. And I want to see about how I know about global markets. I know about Japanese masters. And so this is why I kind of want to leverage the time here to be able to connect it by the technologies when they build, right? So then the tech are really a thing that's a key to transform Japan and also to help Japan to connect to global. Yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah, and so now I want to spend a little time on Timelyhero.
Right.
And so have you officially launched, or is that going to happen in the next with the press release?
Yeah. We already launched at the end of the January.
Nice.
Yeah. So we are currently a live product right now, and so we are seeing the user sign up every day, and so it's good to kind of sort of like it's still too early to say because just a month since we launched, but we are seeing about user growth, registered user growth from one digit to two digit to three digits, you know, on track to four digits right now, and so with the less of a spend on marketing. Right. And so we just like we love the growth, and that will allow me to really focus on, you know, who they are, who the contents we have, and what kind of sellers we have, and how can working backward help them to find the people who purchase their time can match. Right. So we're currently at the early stage, you know, first month. But, you know, we're really glad about the growth we've seen.
Nice. Where can people find it? What's the best way to connect? Is it available on the App Store? Is it where's the best way to yeah.
Yeah, so right now, like, we just want to build the thing. We cover as wide as possible. So that's why we started from the web application.
Okay, cool.
Which is that no matter where we are, we have the internet, we have the browser, you can use our products, right? And so that's why, you know, the people with the phone, with the laptop, you know, wherever you are, no matter where you are, from which country you are, you can use that products. And so, yeah.
Awesome. And so what are some of maybe the services that you've seen or from the people who have registered already?
Yeah, so the services when seeing about, for example, where I see the cartographer that used to have the local, cartography class in the local city, right, in Ebina, right, in Kanagawa Ken. And so, but like, she really, really want to make her services, you know, seen not just everywhere in Japan, as well as to expand globally, and to let a global citizen know about the beauty of the cartography, right? And so that's a kind of a good example about kind of we work together, and so we sort of like we are a win-win platform because there's no upfront cost and there's no monthly cost. So we only, so the business model is very simple. We'll only if your time is sold and there's revenue generated and we get a certain take rate from you, right? And so sort of like win-win thing. So can we sit down with the cartographers and look at what they want to achieve and how they want to achieve, what kind of service they can provide and how can we package that? So so we're kind of seeing about like, well, originally she just provided in-person service in one local city. And right now she's the on top of that, right? So she'll be able to use Timelyhero to allow people to apply their in-person classes. On top of that, she's doing online, right? And calligraphy lessons. So like it's open up to the world to learn calligraphy. And also on top of that, we also help her to build the contents, the video contents, which is like they will be able to, she provides with Japanese contents. Then we use OpenAI, you know, it's gonna and also ChatGPT technology to be able to build the multiple language version of videos, right? And so just almost within one click, we make it possible. So all of a sudden, she has the contents that can be sell globally, right? And so that's something about when I still remember like the word what she told me about when we can make it happen. She said, "Well, that she's like otodoki no hitokoto." That she was like, well, she never knew about IT, but like, you know, when the first time when she said about her face was kind of speaking different language from the video would build for her, then she was like, wow, that's amazing. That's myself. I don't speak that Chinese or, you know, that good English at all, but you know, the video that was built for her was so natural and was she was so satisfied with that. She kind of approved it right away. And I really want to work something long-term with us already. And so it's one of the examples from the early users we've seen for the first month.
That's amazing. That's an amazing example. Yeah, and you touched a little bit there on some of the OpenAI and ChatGPT tools that you're leveraging.
Right.
What are some of the other resources that you guys have been using in your, to launch this business?
Right. So we also leverage some of AWS, some application they are very good at. So we're going to do a little bit hybrid as well. So we kind of leverage each of the cloud service providers' best parts. And right now we kind of leverage more AWS and Microsoft Azure as services and kind of to build the kind of best experience. So what we do is that we just let them compete, right? And so which one will do the better job? The translation services, the speech to text, right? And the conference services, which one is more smooth and, you know, very comfortable use? To my point, right now is reading which one is not which one is cheaper. It's more about which one is better. And because, well, you know, as I said, we really want to build better products and we want to build a product that the user will love, right? And so that's why kind of we really have this kind of mindset about just bring the best of the API, what kind of sort of combined with the multiple things and kind of build that together. And for example, we also work very extensively with Stripe, which is the global payment service provider, right? So right now they're providing payment services for more than 42 countries to support a set of operations there. And also over 135 countries can allow the purchaser to purchase the services, right? And so that's one example about if I build my own payment services, yeah, I could do it. Yeah, maybe I could spend 6 months doing that for one country, right? That would take me for years to build that globally, right? And to have the kind of capability to be able to support global payments, right? So right now, by partnership with them, for example, that will help me to support the local user. Again, I want to support my users to sell it one places. We'll make it available globally. So the time zone conversion, the currency conversions, everything was kind of happen back end, without users being noticed about that. And we kind of will be able to pay them with their local preferred currencies. Like that. So, yeah.
That's great. That's great. That's amazing. And one of the other things that I saw you mention recently was the Microsoft for Startups. How involved is Microsoft there? Or can you tell us a little bit maybe about working with them in this startup?
Yeah. Yeah. So that was actually was kind of out of a surprise, right? So. Well, at the time, I just heard about this Microsoft Startup Program, I think just from the news, mm-hmm. right? And when they launched a program in Japan, two, 3 months ago, that's a new thing, right? And so they wanted support in Japan about the startup companies and to leverage cloud technology to build the cutting edge technologies platform or the kind of business, right? And so, I was thinking about, for me, do I want to build a capability of what Microsoft is capable to do? Probably not now, right? There's no startup can build another Microsoft, right? you don't want to do that, right? So then it was sort of like, we had some ideation. We were in the middle of the building MVP, but the MVP is not even launched yet, right? So it's just built in the middle. And what I did, sort of like, I built the demo video. Right, and I just shoot for the video and said, this is supposed to be working this way. If we'll be able to have this, we'll be able to build that way, right? And so, if that a user will see this, and this is the benefit why we connect user to user, this will be the economic, right? This is kind of things the service the user will have, and this is kind of what we're going to generate from there. And so, we see this will be huge futures, and not just about Japan, it's kind of it will be the global size of the business. So, we talked about we kind of pictures that every founder user to have to learn about. How to talk about your story, how to dream big, right? And so we kind of wrap all these kind of things in the videos and we're gonna send it over to Microsoft. And I said about, well, whatever, 99% would get rejected, right? So like, because we don't even have the products, right? So then how can we get selected by them, right? So I mean, I have nothing to really demo on the, you know, developer environment just yet, just shooting for some imagination videos. And so, but surprisingly, I get a response by then. I said about, hey, Eric, can we have a call? And we want to know more details, right? And so let's just say, oh, wow. I say, I definitely would love it. And so that we kind of set up a call right away. I'm going to explain about more detail about what I came up with the idea with and why I want to try to do this and what kind of technology I require, which that could be something very strong in Microsoft already that we can set up partnership with the others and to kind of, we'll kind of leverage the best of technologies on the platform I'm building and to allow users to have the best technology to use, right? And so, after that calls, and after I think a few days after that, and I was receiving an email say, congratulations, right? So you are selected by the Microsoft for Startup Program. And so what I heard, I'm the first, I think first 10 companies what they had in Japan was selected for that program. So, you know, so I was lucky. Again, I would say that I didn't have the products when I was kind of applying for that program. So. But because of that, I was able to put Microsoft, it was very generous. They would allow me to use their marketing logo or things in my press release when I launched the products, right? And so they provide, so the program itself is the, it's a very good program. Like they will be able to provide you with kind of cloud things they already allow the startup company to use for a certain amount of the credits or things for free, right? And then they also provide a certain marketing support that about we can help you on this. You can use the logo, you can use this market banner, and this potentially will be able to help on this to help help to grow your brand awareness, right? And which is important for a startup because the brand awareness is kind of really the things that you have to grow, and also. One of the biggest things that we love the most is the technical supports that provide. So we are able to have the 24 hours of technical supports and have a dedicated person to assign to us, right? And which we will note about like, hey, we want to build this ABC. We're struggling at this, and we're seeing these problems. We're seeing about latency here. We're seeing about very lagging here and how can we get through it, right? So. Well, again, you cannot just Google it, right? So, and to find an answer for that, but they will be able to sit down from the other side to be able to say, hey, you can use this API. This is how you do change your coding by doing that, and how you to utilize that things, to do that. So that's the best part I love from this program is you get the technical supports, and the most beauty of things, they provide this kind of product technical marketing supports. And also for the company like us was selected by Len, we don't even need to share any equity with them. So it's extensive, like very generous programs, and I would recommend people to apply, for that. And because there's nothing to lose, really, only the things you're gaining, right? So
that's amazing. That's an amazing story. I didn't realize it was that. It was that nice of a program, really. Cool. So those are. That's all the questions that I have for you. Is there any last message that you would want to give maybe to people who are looking to start their own company in Japan or even maybe about like the core mission of Timelyhero? Any last words, really?
Right. So I think I would love to share my experiences about like what would I have done differently, when I started the company, what kind of thing I can prepare more, right? So I wish I could, right? So for the one who maybe consider about opening up or kind of starting your companies, I would suggest you to list down to the skill you need to learn, right? And which I've done that already, right? So I need to oversee the company. I need to know what is P&L, what is balance sheet, right? And how to set up strategies, how to do analysis on the, compare landscape or, product feature or things. And list them down as detailed as possible. Then, and while you're working for your current companies, trying to fill it up, right? So if you don't have lacking with kind of skills, you're gonna be struggling because after you start a company, you wouldn't have time to learn, right? Then you will have to do you can learn from doing, right? So then, so get prepared for the skill you are required for you to, you know, succeed in the companies, right? And so maybe also another thing is to do some of the user interviews or the thing to talk to your potential users about your idea, right? And so, and that's not very expensive, right? So kind of sort of, I didn't remember like that when I do the idea of the restaurant booking system back then. I was actually talking with 100 restaurant owners about, hey, if I'm building this system, are you willing to use, or if yes, how much you're willing to pay, right? And so this kind of approach will apply for every kind of early founder as well, is to check the market, what is the space, and who is going to pay your products, and whether that's the spaces for you to build it before you leave your company, you know? So I think sort of like there's a lot of things you can get well prepared, right? And so that's another thing, is to evaluate whether that's in potential product area. Well, people will love it if you have that, right? So, and that would be a very good signal to tell your current manager about, I'm leaving, I'm ready, you know? So so that would kind of help to build their confidence as well. And the final thing sort of is more about on the financial part of preparation. So I will sort of advise the people to have better have enough saving, so you can self-fund it as much as possible for your companies, right? Instead of like just getting the each of single pennies from the venture capitals and to build your ideas, right? Because from very beginning, very first 1 to 3 years, most of the time people build multiple MVPs, going different direction, the pivot toward different directions, and the bump into the wall can change different directions. And so with your self-funded money, you will have the full control of the thing you want to build, right? And imagine that if you do already do the fundraising, yeah, that was the money help you to build the business. But in the end, like you have to build toward that direction. Even in the middle, you feel about, oh, probably it's not the thing you thought before, right? So have the enough budget to allow more spaces for you to try as many business ideas as possible is a key. Also, imagine about like you have to do a preparation about like you are not going to get paid by yourself maybe for 3 years. Are you able to live, make a life, right? So you definitely need to have some of the saving, even want to do eat instant noodles 3 times a day for 3 years long. That is not free, right? So get prepared for that. So you're not struggling, burning out money. Building business is one thing, making living is another thing, right? You need to make sure you have enough financial to support you to achieve that dream. So that's sort of like the advice I've gone through, and also that I'll provide as advice for the one who's thinking about building their startups.
That's amazing. Yeah, I think those are great lessons, honestly. So one last thing. Are you guys planning to build out the team more at Timelyhero? If you do have hiring plans, maybe what are some of those like attributes that you really look for in people who want to apply?
Yeah, sure. So so we are actively looking for actually the CTO, which is the head of technologies, you know, right? And so to help me to work with me very closely, and to if like the we need to hire the first 10 people that believe in the future of the company, but believe in the vision, right? Let's achieve it, and let's help people to grow the skill horizontally and vertically, and help people to buy and sell their skills and globally. And we believe one day people will live with their skills. And so we need to have the first founding member, to believe in the dream, right? And so we need one of CTO to work with me and to, on a technical perspective, right now I'm a non-tech founder, but I'm actually doing some technical thing myself. I'm working with Microsoft and, you know, to join a lot of like learning things myself. Sometimes I have to write, trying to write a Perl and trying to do that myself as well, you know. So, but I still want the best technical, kind of entrepreneur to join me to achieve this dream together. So yeah, so I'm, you know, actively looking for a CTO and also going forward, we are planning to do a fundraising, very first round of fundraising, maybe like in front of from April and on, we will kind of open it up while we have the first 3 months of the data, like we launch our products. And so with that, we'll be able to do our fundraising for this year. So we're also looking for the company where we believe in the future of this company, who want to invest in this company, so we'll open it up. And so again, to talk with me about what is my steps for next years and this year and how we kind of plan to hiring out the peoples, right? And so that things will help me to secure the budget enough. And so we'll be able to use the budget to hire peoples and to grow the business on the speed that we wish to build, right? And so, yeah, so people and definitely fundraising are something that these steps is something I would fully triple down, you know, on my efforts on making it happen.
That's super exciting. Yeah, I think Timelyhero sounds great. I have a lot of, in my background, I was in LA and the kind of music scene there, and I have a lot of friends who I know would be excited to be able to sell their time in that way. And so it's awesome to hear. I'm excited to see where it goes. Thank you so much, Eric, for spending our time today. And yeah, we hope to have you back soon, and best of luck. I'm excited to see how it goes.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it for Brian. And I know like everybody got skill, right? So like everybody's skill. I really want to encourage you, people to have skills. We're going to make the skill as the like stock markets, right? So like skill will have their price. It's one day, every day will change different price like that, right? So we're building this kind of futures. And so we encourage the people, and if you're watching this these videos, and to be able to check it out, right, tinyhero.com, and take a look and give it a try, and to deploy the best skills and give it a try and help connect to the future opportunities. And appreciate for the time, Brian, and to have this kind of discussion with me today. But again, I really appreciate that Wahl+Case really helped a lot in terms of the connect me from GAFA to startup industries. Also being very helpful in terms of from startup industry to form my own startup as well. And I feel about like it's really there's something that we really prove the things that we can build something, the friendship as well as partnership long term. And really glad to have the time to spend with you, Brian, today, and appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Eric. It was great talking to you.
Thank you.